On April the 18th, 1971, VVAW members from virtually every state in the Union begin arriving in Washington, D.C.'s West Potomac Park, just across the Potomac River from the Pentagon, the staging area from which VVAW would launch a five-day limited incursion into the land of Congress. Their message, bring our brothers home. They called it Operation Dewey Canyon 3, and Country Joe McDonald sang their anthem.
Give me an F! Give me a U! Give me a C!
Country Joe McDonald with the VVAW anthem. And this is the Vietnam Veterans Radio Network. I'm your host, former combat corpsman Doc Upton, transmitting from Liberated Territory. And this is a very special VVRN video transmission. This is the 20th anniversary of Operation Dewey Canyon 3, VVAW's limited incursion into the land of Congress. Morning of 4-20-91, VVAW boarded an unarmored personnel carrier, and the DC-3 20th anniversary action was underway.
Louis,
hey.
John, I'd like to say something at the bar.
Dark over, don't spit.
They're linotypes.
I told Bill Burley, I said, you should tell him to get his papers.
I'm having a flashback.
There was a guy on the radio.
We marched and lobbied, defied, and communed with each other in a politically charged veterans encampment. In 1971, it was a time when our country was open to the socially conscious who were marching for peace and justice. The country listened to us that week as we moved to end the war in a peaceful and dramatic way. We defied Nixon, the Justice Department, and the Supreme Court and Congress, and yet we welcomed senators and representatives to our encampment as we eloquently testified to the experiences in the war. Dewey Canyon 3 will go down in history along with Shays Rebellion and the Bonus March as a demonstration of power of the veteran's voice. I only hope that in 1991, veterans will continue to question our country's motives and commitments to wars abroad and social justice at home. As the late New York City Congressman Adam Clayton Powell used to say, keep the faith, baby. Celebrate Dewey Canyon 3, celebrate VVAW.
I want to welcome everybody. 20 years ago this week, Vietnam Veterans Against the War executed a limited incursion in the U.S. Capitol, and the base camp was right behind us, right on this very spot here. It was absolutely loaded. It was really nice. So 1,500 wild and crazy guys and a handful of pioneering women, and I mean a real small handful, defied the Supreme Court, lobbied Congress, protested a war while it was still raging, and became the first Americans to return combat medals and ribbons on the U.S. Capitol steps. I remember Dewey Canyon 3, and it really changed my life. Today we will commemorate this historical event here on the Mall with speakers. We'll be as short and meaningful as possible. The sooner we're done, the warmer we get. And a wreath laying by this tree right here. This was the tree we planted 20 years ago to honor the dead in Vietnam. Well, then March, out of step, over to the U.S. Capitol. We'll try a couple cadences while we're going also. And while we're at the steps, we'll remember the 3.5 hours it took us to file by and deposit our medals and ribbons and prosthesis and discharge papers. And it was all to show what we felt about the war. The speakers will proudly point to the historic act and at the VVW's prominence in the long history of the veterans movement. Like Eddie had mentioned, Shays Rebellion in the Revolutionary War, the Bonus Army of the World War I vets in the 1930s. We're going to be marching right by Northwest 3rd and Pennsylvania Avenue where they took KIAs during their occupation, actually lost some people killed by MacArthur's troops. And we're part of this movement and proud of it. We're glad we didn't have to take KIAs on 3rd and Pennsylvania though. We will also march to our National VA headquarters using the sidewalk on Pennsylvania Avenue because honor the dead and fight like hell for the living has always been a part of VVAW's history. We're proud of it. How many of you were here for Dewey Canyon 3 or part of it? I'll be dipped. All right. How many of you were in Vietnam or the U.S. military and remember hearing about it?
Yeah.
All right. So basically we're remembering where we were at and it'll be in our mind forever. This demo touched many people and forever changed their lives. At the time, I'd never guessed that I'd still be working for peace or decent benefits 20 years later. I figured that 20 years ago, if I went to D.C., America would listen to its veterans.
Talk to veterans. They're here all week to be talked to. They'll tell you things you won't believe.
We learned that it takes more than this. It takes a lifetime of commitment, generation after generation, to keep things moving along. Our VVAW demo happened right before this nation's largest anti-war demo on April 25th, 1971. We led that march and we know it helped to shorten our 14-year war. Never before had veterans testified to war crimes they committed or witnessed. We did.
I was told by the other pilots in the unit how to tell a VC from a civilian. If they were running, they were VC. If they were standing there, they were well-disciplined VC shoot him anyhow.
We used the Winter Soldier investigation as a tool to expose the American war policy. We also perfected guerrilla theater to an art on a mass scale. In fact, I remember 100 of us chasing the commandant of the Marine Corps down the hall when he tried to sneak out of a congressional hearing through a side door, and we threw our empty styrofoam coffee cups at him, and we weren't necessarily making a statement about recycling. One thing we did not force our government to do is recognize Vietnam politically as a nation in the world. And Vietnam Veterans Against the War demands normal relations with Vietnam by our country.
Right on.
Yeah.
Just because this war tore apart our country, there's no reason for an economic and political embargo against Vietnam for the last 16 years. This act is long overdue, and I stand in my nation's capital and say enough is enough. Normalize relations with Vietnam now. After Dewey came to 3 VVAW as an organization really took off. At one time we had 25,000 people on a mailing list, hundreds of active duty members with over 1,500 on a mailing list in Vietnam. We do 3 national actions a year, hundreds of local actions, more meetings than I'd like to remember. And some of our members went to Congress, some became doctors, some finally rejoined the roles of the workers that often after they became GI Bill slaves. Others will forever remain the walking wounded. Some sent to prison and some died. This unfortunately happened all too often. Many remark how strange it is that VVAW remained active even after the war ended. I credit this to our continued work around decent benefits for all veterans and the testing, treatment, and compensation for Agent Orange victims. In 1973, VVAW started what we call the War on the VA with a takeover of the regional office in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. We realized that all veterans, no matter what the politics, had to fight for decent health care. 10 years of the Reagan-Bush cutbacks have left the VA system near collapse. The new Gulf veterans will face the same problems, and their fight to help them get benefits will help them to organize, just like we had to. Even when the Vietnam War ended, we had plenty left to do with the struggle for decent benefits and no more war, and then the Agent Orange story broke. Vaughn DeVictor of Chicago blew the story wide open with the March 1978 release of The Deadly Fog on local TV. This, along with the death of Paul Rudisham, crystallized the movement. Paul's quote, "They killed me in Vietnam and I didn't even know it," was our battle cry.
I got out of the Navy March 1st of 1971.
I was pissed off as hell. I had done some organizing against the war within the military. I got busted for distributing underground papers. And I came back, I was mad as hell. When I read about Dewey Canyon 3, I knew I had to join VVAW. I have a short statement from Jerry Genesio, who's the executive director of Veterans Peace. Make no mistake, George Bush's Persian Gulf War did not bury the Vietnam Syndrome in the sands of the Arabian deserts. He reopened the wounds of Vietnam and made them bleed. Like those who snatched defeat from the jaws of victory, George Bush chose war and rejected peace. If he had chosen peace, he could have turned the Vietnam Syndrome into a positive influence on the world's future. Indeed, he could have given those who served in Vietnam the noble cause they fought and died for. He did not bury the Vietnam Syndrome in the sands of the Middle East. He buried the Vietnam War's noble cause even as it was being born. But desert sands tend to shift with the winds, allowing neither gods nor mortals to deny the past. The lessons of Vietnam and the Enlightenment reflected by the medals returned during Dewey Canyon 3 will survive. That noble cause will be resurrected, and the march will continue until government leaders reject the notion that it is acceptable to solve their political problems by murdering their children.
And in the last 20 years working with this organization, I guess my biggest remarks and my biggest memories have to do with issues around health care. I am the medic. I just tried to convince the youngsters that nobody screams unless there's blood, but they're not getting it. And Vietnam veterans have been screaming because there's been blood all of these years. The issues that are about to come up with the Gulf War, Andy will probably be talking more about later, but things we're already seeing are things like pneumonias and oil emboli and ugly stuff that's coming from the exposure to what passes for air in the Middle East. I think that this organization will probably, unfortunately, have to go on for another 20 years. And I hope the parties just keep getting better.
Yeah! Yeah!
It might be the only thing that sustains us.
Now I'd like to take the time to ask for a moment of silence. We're going to commemorate the well over 58,000 American men and women, the 5,600 Australian, all of our other allies who died, plus the over 1 million Vietnamese who died during the war, the countless thousands who died in the aftermath, and the over 60,000 veterans who died since their return.
Soviet Union today and what's going on, the newscasters constantly say, what kind of government is it that has to shut off Red Square to its citizens, to deny people the right to speak? And I remember 20 years ago when they surrounded this capital with barbed wire to keep 2,000 of their own veterans from protesting the war they fought in. Originally, we'd asked to be on the steps, and that was denied. This is where we are supposed to be. And the reason was, of course, because they can't trust their own citizens on the steps again.
The House Un-American Activities Committee has rated our organization the third greatest threat to internal security in this country, right after the Weathermen and the Black Panthers.
Our first speaker is going to be one of the other national coordinators. It's going to be Dave Klein.
Now, I was hoping they would put up a fence here because I didn't have the opportunity to come up to Washington for Dewey Canyon 3, and I said if they had a fence up, I was going to throw Louis DiBenedetti back and protest the war in the Persian Gulf. But Louis thinks because they failed to put up a fence.
Yeah.
Okay?
Across the board in the center.
It's trespassing.
I got out of the Army in 1969 and joined Vietnam Veterans Against the War in 1970 and was down in Texas as part of an organizing project for servicemen when Dewey Canyon 3 took place. and can still remember the impact it had for GIs to hear about ex-GIs returning their medals and protesting the war and the powerful movement that was developing back in them days. I think we should take a look for a minute at where we've come since then. I know John talked about it a little. And I would say that today the slogan, "We're looking for a few good men and women," applies just as much as it did before and just as much as the military can say it. Because if we look at what's happened since 1975 or 73 with the end of the war, the struggle for justice for veterans has continued. The war against the people in this country for our for better living and working conditions and for a decent life has continued. And we are still in the same boat we were in, except for it just keeps getting worse. I can remember seeing the movie where the one guy returning his medal says, "We don't want to fight anymore, but if we do, it's going to be to take those steps."
Right now.
"We don't want to fight anymore, but if we have to fight again, it'll be to take these steps."
And I can say that since some days that we found that the place has not only turned into a contested zone, it's turned into an enemy camp. The struggle around for democracy and for people's rights in this country has become more necessary today than it was then. Because after the war ended, people used to say, "Why are you Vietnam veterans against the war? The war is over." But the reality is the war didn't end. It just moved to another country. It moved to Nicaragua. It moved to El Salvador. It moved to the Philippines. It really didn't even move out of Vietnam because we're still conducting economic warfare against the people of Indochina. Today we're supporting the genocidal Khmer Rouge who murdered one-tenth of their population because we find it expedient to support them because the government and the leaders in our country still continue to nurse a grudge because we didn't win the Vietnam War. Right. And now the government of this country is real proud because we won a big victory in the Persian Gulf. You know, America stands tall. You know, we lost 100 and some service people. Forget about the fact that 100 to 200,000 Iraqis were killed. Forget about that. They don't even give you those numbers. Those numbers are unknown. Forget about the fact that there's no light at the end of the tunnel. They used to say light at the end of the tunnel. Where is the light at the end of the tunnel in the Middle East? Look at the agony of the Kurdish people today. Or look at even the existence of Saddam Hussein, our enemy this time, who was our ally last time, who we built up. Just like the last war, the invasion of Panama, our enemy who we had built up. We had better begin looking at our foreign policy, because today we heard President Bush, recently we heard President Bush say, "By God, we've kicked the Vietnam syndrome." Now first off, I think it's interesting that someone would want to kick the Vietnam syndrome. Because if we shouldn't be kicking any Vietnam syndrome, we should be learning from Vietnam. And the worst you can say about the Vietnam syndrome is that it's a reflective reaction to Vietnam instead of an intellectual or learned political conclusion. Because the Vietnam syndrome means fundamentally that we don't have the right to send our troops to police other countries in the world. That we are one more nation in the world, a strong nation, a rich nation, but one more nation, and we have to learn to live in harmony with other people. Until this country learns that, we're going to continue going into war after war after war.
Robert Jones, New York. I symbolically return all Vietnam medals and other service medals given me by the power structure that has genocidal policies against non-white peoples of the world.
Right on.
All power to the people.
As my FBI file says, the first page is a suspected member of Vietnam Veterans Against the War. I think it must have been the patch that helped them come up with that. I've been through a lot of interesting experiences, like being beaten up by the police, and being charged with assault for being beaten up. By the way, it's going around that Chief Gates in L.A. was trying to make it make a 7-day waiting period to buy those camcorders. I've been to a lot of bad experiences. I've been to graduate school, jail, and all through that, everybody, and prison even, and all through that, people have always said that's that crazy Vietnam veteran against the war, Dave Curry. So I want to thank you all and tell you how much I respect and love you for making me part of you and how proud I was of you in 1971. And thanks for letting me be part of you, all of you.
The main thing I want to do is just share with you one of the most memorable aspects that reflected the intensity of which we felt during Operation, during Dewey Canyon 3. One of the guys online who didn't have his medals had his discharge papers, and what he did was to slice open his arm with a church key or a can opener, since nobody immediately around us had a knife, to get his blood on his discharge papers, and that is what he returned over the fence.
This is an honorable discharge. It says, from the Armed Forces of the United States of America, this is to certify that Alan Wallace Morentz, Airman Second Class Regular Air Force, was honorably discharged from the United States Air Force on the 23rd day of May, December 66. Down at the bottom it says, this is an important record, safeguard it.
With the recent buildup and the war in the Gulf, I know my own feelings during that whole period. One of the biggest insults, I think, that we as a group have suffered was when Bush says the Vietnam Syndrome has been defeated. I think that is...
New York, a lot of shit.
I used to be very pro, I say very conservative. I'm one of those Chicanos from Texas that were very pro Johnson, good old boys. The problem was that I was very naive. El Salvador changed me. El Salvador, I saw the truth of U.S. policy, U.S. foreign policy. In El Salvador, we are supporting a repressive, neo-fascist government, neo-Nazi government that kills priests, that kills an archbishop, kills nuns, that kills labor people, that kills peasants, that kills babies.
I pray that time will forgive me and my brothers what we did. And only those lumping pigs behind those closed doors have to suffer, and not the young kids and the unborn kids.
And yet, we keep supporting this government with our own tax money to the tune of $1.5 million daily.
Dennis Kroll is coordinator of the Madison, Wisconsin chapter of Vietnam Veterans Against the War. This past May, during Operation Blanket Hill, we asked Dennis which single VVAW action or experience was foremost in his memory.
Well, the one that sticks in my mind most is one that I didn't attend right after I came home from Vietnam and started dealing with my own personal experiences. I wasn't relating well to anybody, including Vietnam veterans, because of their attitude. You know, they were on what I call jungle heroes. They all wanted to talk about the war, how they won it single-handedly. I couldn't deal with their racist attitudes, their sexist attitudes. So I was pretty much outcast from everybody. I heard about Dewey Canyon 3. And when I heard about that, I knew there were other people who thought the way I was thinking. Started picking up a little bit of news on it. It was pretty much blacked out in my area, but everything I could find on it, I read. I told my wife at the time, my family, friends. I said, "This is it. I have to go to here." You know, it meant a lot to me to see it, hear about it. Unfortunately, family and friends said, "You know, you can't do it." My wife actually threatened to leave me if I did go, but in my mind, that is the most important thing, because at that point I knew that there were veterans who came back from the war who had been changed by it.
Thank you.
Drafted again. It's great to be here and see all of you. Been here many times before, and always for the right reasons. And I'm just getting into it. It's hard to tell you how I feel. But I hope we have a good demo today, and we keep on working on. Thank you all.
Thank you, Mike. A few years ago, we came to Washington and said we were going to have Dewey Canyon 4 because the struggle of vets never stops. And the next person I want to ask to speak put us up in their home. Took care of us, kept us from going insane, and I think we drove them a little insane. But Shaughnessy, would you please come and say a few words? Actually, VVAW still owes us a bill from the last time they were here. Welcome to D.C. and the New World Order. Part of the New World Order is that you can now walk on the grass today. 20 years ago, I look back and I think about Dewey Canyon 3, and I look in the mirror and I say, I wasn't gray, I was 30 pounds lighter, I didn't have a cane, and my hair was longer. It's sort of funny to start reflecting that early in the morning of the changes that have come over you. But in a sense, there hasn't been too many changes because VVAW is still crazy after all these years. Back in January, when we were having a demonstration against the war in the Gulf, or what the Army now terms the Southwest Asia campaign, that's official. I was standing with a group of VVAW from Chicago and New York. And there was a group of Abraham Lincoln Brigade fellows right behind us. One of the people from, I believe, New York turned to them and said, you know, I really appreciate what you people have done for us. It was you, Abraham Lincoln Brigade people, that raised my consciousness and got me started in VVAW in the 1960s. 2 hours later, a group of young people, about 20 years old, walked up to me, a group of us who were standing holding a VVAW banner, and said almost the damned identical thing. So we have a long tradition. I'm glad to be part of it, and I'm glad to see people come back to Washington after all these years and honor our heritage. Thank you.
As Barry said, there's two of us here from the Midwest, specifically from Champaign-Urbana, and we are here to represent a small number of veterans, World War II, Korea, Vietnam veterans, and current reservists and National Guards people who participated inside the Committee Against the War in the Gulf at the University of Illinois as the Veterans Caucus. We made it a point at the beginning of this organization last fall to not allow the media, not allow the government to paint the anti-war movement in this unpatriotic tone and to pretend that veterans would stay away from it. So we tried to keep ourselves visible. I was not here for Dewey Canyon 3. I was stuck in Chicago watching it on the news, which was also exciting to some extent. I wanted to be here, and I certainly wanted to be here this time around because when I was in the Tonkin Gulf in 1964, having come out of the Naval Security Group and knowing what the USS Maddox was doing out there and having friends on the Maddox who were doing the spying, and not having spoken up quicker to voice my opposition, I didn't really become an anti-war GI until 1965, and then I spent the next 3 years trying to keep myself from getting put in the brig in the Navy. But I didn't speak up quick enough, and I didn't try to save more lives, I felt. And I've carried a lot of that with me for a long time. I looked it up once, and since the Tonkin Gulf incidents in 1964, 46,000 troops American troops died in Vietnam, not counting the men and women, civilians, and others that died after that point. So I'm here basically to try to voice my connection with all the rest of you. I have been a member of VVAW on and off for the past 20 years, and it's always been a great time to be together with you people. And I brought my medals and discharge papers, copies of, and all that kind of stuff, and thought I might have a chance to throw them back today. But I, as I'm standing here, I'm having a better thought. Since we invited John Kerry to come here and he didn't show, I figure I'm going to put them in the mail. I'll send them to him. Okay. Thank you.
I lost my leg in Vietnam. I totally oppose this war we're carrying on over there. And Senator Buckley and Congressman James Hanley will receive my medals next week in the mail. Thank you.
I have a statement here in support of the Camp Lejeune conscientious objectors. The president finally found it in his heart to stop dropping bombs on Iraqi civilians and retreating soldiers. And for this, we are relieved. But the war against conscientious objectors in the military continues. 22 Marine reservists who insist that the war should never have happened await court-martial. All in their 20s, these Marines are African, white, Latino, and Asian Americans who refuse to be part of the Gulf techno carnage. Faced with the palatable prospect of killing, they all sought counseling. Most have never heard of conscientious objector before, and others were unaware that they could apply. Once they understood what CO status was, their moral duty was clear. Preparation of their CO applications took several weeks, and therefore they reported late for duty. As a result, they all faced court-martial up to 7 years in prison on charges of desertion, even though they voluntarily reported, and missing movement, a relatively common misdemeanor that usually results in minor, often non-judicial punishment. But now the desert storm has blown over, the Marine Corps is determined to push for retributive punishment. COs are being given harsher charges and longer sentences than Marines who committed similar offenses but were not COs. Eric Hayes, who was court-martialed before the war began, was sentenced to 2.5 years in the brig. This is more than twice as long as sentences handed out to Marines convicted of manslaughter and armed robbery of munitions. Isolated in separate conscientious objector barracks, the resistors have been subjected to endless harassment, spared others who committed similar offenses but did not file for CO status. Two have been in 6x8 solitary confinement cells. Clearly, the Corps considers refusal to kill to be a greater crime than killing itself. This harassment must stop. The confinement must stop. These prisoners of conscience have committed no crime injurious to others. Their incarceration contradicts everything we believe in the United States of America and its Constitution to represent. We demand that all charges be dropped, these COs be set free. We insist on peace with justice.
Yeah!
To the brothers and sisters at camp. To the brothers and sisters this year.
I joined the Marine Corps in 1966. You know, to go off and fight for freedom and democracy, I thought. You know, my eyes had been blinded by the propaganda and culture of this country. And that was for 4 years. Little did I realize that I was going, once my eyes were open to what goes on in the world, realize I was going to join an organization for the rest of my life. But it's been that way. Because once I got to Vietnam, my eyes did open up. And it opened up not only to the killing that was going on in Vietnam and the injustice there, but it opened up to the injustice and racial oppression and discrimination in this country also.
It's a bunch of bullshit.
More bullshit!
I returned from Vietnam and got out of the Marine Corps. 2 months later, I was here participating in Dewey Canyon 3. At the conclusion, I wrote a letter back to some people I knew in Vietnam just to let them know that somebody here cared. I want to read some excerpts from that. Hi, Crow. How are things in Da Nang? Things have been great for me since I returned in February. The highlight was last week's End the War demonstration in D.C. by the Vietnam Veterans Against the War. Activities started Monday morning, April 19th, with the march of about 900 vets to Arlington Cemetery. Outside its gate, we had a memorial and then tried to enter Arlington. We, who had supposedly served our country in Vietnam, were denied admittance. Our disappointment and anger were obvious, but we remained nonviolent, except for one brother who smashed a toy M16 against the gates. That afternoon, we started to lobby with senators and congressmen. At least we tried. Of all the representatives from Pennsylvania, I was from Pittsburgh at the time, only Moorhead from Pittsburgh was available. We heard every kind of bullshit story imaginable, from a dead brother to a trip to Europe. As the week progressed, we had better luck with lobbying. This, I feel, was due to the press coverage. The pressure was just too much. Congressmen had to see us. Wednesday, we marched on the Supreme Court to ask them to rule on the constitutionality of the war. We were denied admittance, sat down in the steps, and then were told we had to leave the Supreme Court grounds altogether. Thursday, about 150 went back and tried again, this time with the idea of getting busted if they could not get in. They could not get in, and they did get busted, but it was great. Each person submitted to arrest as a prisoner of war. At first, they were charged with obstruction of justice, some crap about trying to influence a judge. This offense had a maximum penalty of $5,000 and or 1 year in jail, with bail set at $500 a head. The charge was shortly changed to disorderly conduct. This means a $10 fine if found guilty. The trial was on Friday, and the judge dismissed the charges. All kinds of other crap went on that week. Brothers rapping with people in the street, a candlelight march Thursday night. Decorations on Friday, etc. The whole week was beautiful. A guerrilla army had come to D.C., most of whom had spent a year in Vietnam. We had paid our dues, and now the government was going to hear us. What we had to offer was upwards of 1,000 years of first-hand knowledge, not the watered-down crap that comes through official channels. We, more than anyone else in this country, have the right to speak and be heard about this messed-up war. I guarantee you, Crow, that our voices are being heard and will continue to be heard until all our brothers and sisters return and the Vietnamese can once again return to the land and villages which are theirs. Take care, Dave. That was 20 years ago. I'm here today because I have two young boys, and I want to be sure 20 years from now I don't have to write the same kind of letter for them.
22nd Cavalry's fighting Da Nang, and I hope they realize it's their last goddamn chance. Yeah.
Well, my son was killed in Vietnam, Quezon Valley, in 1962. He was killed on January the 2nd. And they came to tell me on January the 8th that he was missing. But all the time, he was there and they couldn't get the wounded out because there was 100 or 150 men killed that day. And Westmoreland knew it. He knew they were ambushed. My son held off the enemy until all the wounded were loaded on the choppers. Then when he tried to go for safety, he was killed. And like a month later, they brought his body back home. But I never saw it. I never got his personal belongings or anything. And I think Westmoreland should be held for treason and murder for what he did.
My name is Peter Brannigan, and I got a purple heart here, and I hope I get another one fighting these motherfuckers.
Thank you.
that herbicide.
They said it only killed a tree. But now I got this strange disease. Pound off.
One, two.
Pound off.
And four. One, two, three, four.
Three, four. If they ever want you to go. There is something you should know.
There is something you should know.
You're up.
10 blocks.
one thing has been sure since the Nixon administration in particular, and continuing unabated even through that one brief Democratic administration, veterans benefits and the care for veterans and the meeting the general needs of veterans have been in a downhill slide. At the same time, the budget has been increasingly larger for the VA, and larger amounts, like some massive charitable organization, seems to be going more and more for administrative costs and less for care. They're building more and more VA facilities, and yet every year we lose another 1,000 to 2,000 bed spaces, and it's incomprehensible how it can be building new hospitals and every year we're getting less bed space. But what it is the places, since they became a major outlet and a money-making thing for various universities and medical schools when they hooked up with those systems, it's become more and more an experimental place.
The money is gone, the counselors are gone, and it's at a time when veterans need health care services at the VA more than ever.
The case against the VA has been a steady one, and making it a cabinet position hasn't appeared to have made any significant difference, except it's more directly under control of the White House instead of less than it used to be.
Now they're saying if you have a job and you're not 100% disabled, we're going to give a means test. You're going to have to share the cost of your health care. These are the people who said that they would protect the lives and health and families of people who are willing to go and serve in the military regardless of where they were sent.
We've always had problems in Chicago with guys being left to die in elevators, and recently it got a lot worse when information came forward and was uncovered in the North Chicago facility, which has been primarily a mental facility and a stress facility. Upwards of somewhere between 75 and 100 guys died unnecessarily under the knife, under some pretty dubious, questionable conditions, and they've closed down the entire surgical facility of the North VA facility pending further investigation and possible criminal charges against the entire surgical staff, which leads to a lot of confidence in going to the VA. The point that Annie was making is maybe some of us have jobs and decent benefits and we can go, as long as those benefits hold up in our contract, we can pick out good medical care. But so many people in this country don't have those kind of jobs. They don't have, increasingly numbers don't have those jobs, don't have those benefits, and increasing number of veterans will be turning to the VA. And they'll be told, well, you've got 10 kids, it has nothing to do with the fact that you make $13,000. You're veritably a wealthy man, and you're going to have to pay for treatment here, you know. And that's their whole attitude.
The Atomic Vets wrote us a letter, and in this letter, they talked about in the 50s when they were used in the atomic testing and they were occupation troops in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, there were quite a few thousand of them who had problems as a result of exposure to radiation. There are now only 432 of those guys left out of tens of thousands. And what they said to us in this letter that they sent to our national office was, we have to band together because the VA policy and the congressional policy is to just keep putting us off until we die. But we're not going to be put off anymore.
As we continue our fight against U.S. military intervention around the world, we also have to continue our fight here at home for the people who get used in those interventions and the kind of benefits that the problems they're going to be having. When we came back from Vietnam and started fighting for decent benefits, we quickly went to the concept of fighting for decent benefits for all veterans, because we knew a few years down the road that things we were fighting for, that the World War II and Korean veterans were going to be needing them in increasing numbers. That has come true, and now we're moving into the age group where we need that necessary care too, and quite frankly, it's not there.
So here we are, 20 years after Dewey Canyon 3, and I think today it's time to renew our call for a war on Congress and the VA until they accommodate every veteran in this country.
All right! All right!
having completed their three-phased DC-3 20th anniversary action, VVAW reboarded the unarmored personnel carrier for the return to their base camp at the Howard University Inn. And a debriefing.
Somebody who knows fashion, right?
Hey, man. This has been a Vietnam Veterans Radio Network video transmission.